Okay, so this is more of a hobby of mine. It's not exactly game dev related, but it kind of has to do with game. So I thought I'd talk to you about how I cheated at EVE Online in the coolest way I could find, and let's see how it goes. Today's weird Japanese drink is Canada Dry Peach Ginger Ale. So let's find out. Smells peachy. You know what? It's pretty good. Hey everyone, and welcome to another episode. So about a year and a half ago, me and a coworker at my previous job, shout out to Baliphen, we decided we wanted to learn about machine learning. And the thing is if you follow online classes or read articles about machine learning, the examples they use is kind of hard to understand. And I think the best way to really understand how machine learning works is to actually try to implement some kind of machine learning algorithm. But to do that, you need some kind of project. You can't just implement a machine learning hello world or something. You need something to train your machine learning on. And so we were looking for some small projects that we could get our sink our teeth into to learn a little bit the basics. At that time, there was an interesting mini game inside EVE Online that was a massive gamification effort to crowdsource protein marker identification for a project called the Human Protein Atlas. Basically, how it works is while you're traveling between Star System and EVE Online, you can waste some time earning some credits helping an actual research project by playing this mini game. It looks a little bit like this. You have a picture of a cell on the right, encoded in RGB, red for cytoplasm, blue for nuclei, and something in green that you have to identify. There's about 27 categories on the left that you have to choose from, and there can be more than one categories highlighted in the picture. It's a tricky feat for computers to accomplish called a multi-label classification problem. And that's why the university sponsoring the project was using humans to perform the identification. As I was playing EVE Online and playing a lot of this minigame, I started getting more and more familiar with how to identify each categories. And I started thinking that if I could extract some simple characteristic about the image that was presented to me, I could probably figure out how to automate the classification and write an AI that would play the minigame for me and earn me some credits. At first, I thought I could probably brute force it. So basically, first extract the characteristics, like for example, the percentage of green pixels with also blue, and the percentage of red pixels with also green, or something like that, and then just write a bunch of conditions, like if green and blue are together, then it's category 3, and if there's more red on top of green, then it's probably category 5 or something like that. But as there's 27 categories, the conditions became complicated really fast and really complicated. Enter machine learning, and I'm talking specifically about neural network, because they're kind of basically just a regression matching algorithm. So what I mean by that is that if you have as input a bunch of unknowns, like 20 different unknowns, and you know the result of your formulas, which is the result you expect the machine learning to give you, then you just need to figure out the parameters to get the result you want from your inputs. You know, it's basically like the classic, like how do you solve AX plus B equal Y or something like that. I'm sure you've all learned that in mathematics. I know linear algebra is pretty painful, but in computer science, we often have to deal with these kind of things, so it's something really practical to know about. So, how do you solve something when you have AX plus B equal Y, and if you know that for X equal 2, Y equal 3, and if you have 2 points on your line, then you can solve and you can figure out what is A and what is B? Well, imagine the same thing, but instead of A and B, you have like A, B, C, D, all the way to triple Z. And that's basically what machine learning does, except it cannot solve the formula through simple mathematics like you can do with the linear algebra. You have to use much more complex algorithm, but it's basically the same thing. It's just trying to fit the parameters to the solution you have. But to train a neural network, you need actual data with known answers. And the way this minigame worked in Eve is that if you were a bad player, it would show you the correct answer after you've chosen your wrong answers. So what I ended up doing is first make an AI that would just play categories randomly and then receive the answer at the end, take a screenshot of the answer, and figure out which were the correct answer and categorize them in some kind of array that I could later access to test and train my neural network. So the design was kind of made in two parts. There's not much design to the code per se. Actually, it's one of the most ugly code I've ever written, but that's because I had no idea where I was going, so I kind of made it up as I go. So just bear with me, right? There kind of was two parts to this. The first part had nothing to do with machine learning. It was really more about how do I control the game from Python scripts. And to do that, I imported all the Win32 APIs library from Python so that I could do stuff like capture the screen. And once the screen is captured, that then load it as a bitmap or save it as a screenshot or something like that, and then do some processing on it. And also, there's some methods to move the mouse. So as you can see here, I have a method test click. So once I had figured out all the coordinates of my buttons in the screen, I would move the mouse to each of those buttons so that I could test to make sure that all the buttons were identified correctly. And then from that, I could click on the buttons, click on the continue, click on the next screen, and try to figure out which screen I'm on. I tried to make it as robust as possible so that even maybe if the game, for example, for some reason disconnect or something, then the game would be able to like shut it down and restart it and then go to the right menus to restart the game. And all of this was working pretty well. So one of the tricks I use is to figure out in which screen I was, I would find a specific color inside my screen. And if this color was there, I knew I was on, for example, screen number 2 or screen number 3 or continue screen or something like that. And then I had data for each of my buttons. I had took screenshots of each of the buttons I needed so that I could search for them using NumPy and the Python image library. And I stored most of these in global variables because it was just the easiest way to do. I really wouldn't recommend doing that at all. Since I don't know what kind of data I'm going to need, I prefer to store it inside a JSONs array and dictionaries so that I can pass it to different methods. And at the same time, I kind of keep a structure that I can at any time save on the disk if I want to, so that I can restart the process from some specific points in my code without having to redo everything, because some of these steps kind of take a lot of time. And then once I had all the processing of the game done and I could find myself in the screens and I could take screenshots and I could save them on the disk and I could do all of this, then I started trying to take this information and generate JSON data arrays and dictionaries that I could use to train some machine learning. And to train the machine learning, I used something called SKLearn, which is a Python library that does a lot of machine learning, regressions, and, you know, general mathematics stuff. And it's really nice because it's quite newbie-friendly. It's easy to use. It's not the most powerful. If you really want to do like a deep learning, deep machine learning, reinforcement learning, and a little bit of these more complex things, you're probably better off with using something like TensorFlow. So here's the set of data I was planning to use. So as you can see, I have like a total green, total blue, percentage of red with green, percentage of blue with green. And like I was saying, I was hoping that these input that are a little bit processed, it's not just the raw image, it's kind of information I've already computed. I was hoping that this would help the machine converge more quickly and give me good results. So first, generating the JSON, I would just iterate through all the data I had saved, like about 1,000 image, and I would compute different values like percentage of green, percentage of red, and stuff like that. And then I would save this in a JSON. So it was really simple, just iterating on all my image and then saving it as a JSON. And then once all my data was updated and the file was up to date, then I could generate my machine. And this is the method that I used to load the JSON for the training and then generate the JSON and then pass the JSON to my machine learning. So in the end, these are the settings I used for my machine. It's an MLP classifier from the SKLearn library. If we go on the website of the SKLearn library, one thing that's really amazing is the documentation. You'll be able to understand all of the concepts of machine learning and deep learning and regressions and stuff like that quite easily by just going through the documentation for the library. For example, this is the homepage of the scikit-learn library, and you have like all the classification, regression, clustering. I mean, it doesn't just do machine learning. You can do a whole lot of image processing, data processing and stuff like that with SKLearn. And it's really, really made to learn about these kind of things. So they'll explain it even if you're a complete beginner in a way that you'll understand. So if you go into supervised learning, you can see that there's a lot of different things, you know, least square, ridge regression, lasso, perceptron, you know, you can understand all these concepts. And if you look, the one I decided to use was the MLP classifier, and you can have really good description of what each parameters that I used in my code, like if you look here, like the solver, the alpha, the hidden layer, the random state, all of these, you have good documentation of what they do and in which case maybe sometimes one would be better than the other. And you even have like some notes and examples and, you know, all the documentation you might need. And you can also see, for example, if you go here, you're going to see a graph of the different methods and what kind of results you can expect from them. So if you see, this is the input data, and if you use the nearest neighbor to partition your data, this is the kind of result you're going to get. If you use a linear SVM, this is the kind of result you're going to get. If you use on a RBF SVM, then this is what you're going to get. And if you use a decision tree, if you use a neural network, and so on and so on. And this is really amazing because depending on your data and depending on the way your data is split, you might need one or the other. The SVM is really great if your data is pretty well partitioned. If you know that something is in category A and will never be in category B, then the SVM should be able to trace a beautiful line just across your data to partition it into two or multiple sections. But in my case, since it was kind of fuzzy and you could be in multiple categories, SVM wasn't working so great. And I found out that the LBGFS separator was working pretty well. But depending on what you're doing, you have to try different ways. And if you understand a little bit how it works, then it can help you figure out which one is better for your application. And that was basically it. Once I had the machine, I could save the machine and I could load it and start playing the game without having to do the training again. And I saved it using just the pickle library from Python, which can pickle any kind of data structure you have. And once it was loaded, then I could start clicking and processing the current image and selecting and playing the game. And it was giving some interesting result, and it was really beautiful to watch it going. I mean, I could sit there and look at it for 10-15 minutes, just being amazed at how it would choose the right answers and then just keep going and without me doing anything. The results weren't as good as I would have hoped. It still managed to get more than 50% of the answers right, which was enough in the game to get you the highest reward in Eve. So that was what I set out to do, and in that sense, I succeeded. But really, I was hoping to get much more than 55% or so of proper, correct answers. But I was kind of excited that my first project was a success. After the project in Eve ended, the university even went to Kaggle to run an actual competition on who could create the best neural network to identify the proteins marker. And when I saw that, I was quite excited to pitch my own little Python script against the best of the best data analysts in the world. And in the end, yeah, as expected, for a first project, it didn't do so well. I got maybe 20 or 25%, and the best of the best got around something like 72 or 75%, I think. So that's going to be it for me, everyone. I hope you're not too insulted about me trying to cheat at EVE Online, but really it was just a project to learn about machine learning, and I really did learn a lot at that time, and also when I did the competition on Kaggle. It was a great time, and I learned a lot, and I think everyone should do the best to learn about machine learning. If you have any resource, comments, suggestions, just leave a message at the bottom, leave a like, subscribe, and see you guys in my next episode. Bye!